It's 2 o'clock on listener-supported radio, KPFA, KPFB, Berkeley, and KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. It's time for About Health with Dr. Michael Lenoir. This is an encore show.
Health and welcome to today's edition of About Health. I'm your host, Dr. Mike Lenoir. Today, we're going to continue our open line segment. For those of you who have got questions or contributions you want to make, we never quite get them all in. If you've got an issue or you've got a health problem, you've got something that you want to say about health, we want to invite you to join us today on About Health. We've had a couple of vigorous sessions and going to do this mostly through the month of January. Then we'll kind of go back to our old format. But in some of the emails I've got, people have questions and things that they want to contribute, and we haven't given them always the opportunity to do so. So today we're going to continue that form. So let me give you our numbers, 848-4425, the 510 area code, 1-800-958-9008 is our 800 number. So that if you've got something that you want to say and if you've got issues that you want addressed, then go ahead and give us a call. Well, let's start out with violence. Obviously, this has been a very down weekend for most people. I mean, obviously, this whole issue of a very disturbed individual who shot these people in Arizona, I think, is something that we have to pay attention to as a nation. Too many of these episodes, from Columbine to Virginia Tech, there's always something going on. And one of the things that really kind of not surprises me, but disappoints me, is that the healthcare system, this is an individual that should have had 5 tags on him for the last several years, is somebody who is clearly not capable of making rational decisions. And I would be very hesitant to put a political twist to it because a disturbed individual can do anything. However, I do think the rhetoric in this country serves as a background for many of the problems that we see now. I do think the availability of guns, if this guy got a gun, I mean, come on. What kind of screening process could we be using? This whole issue of guns don't kill people, people kill people. Well, when I get mad, I don't have a gun, so I mean, I have to do something else. I have to talk to the individual, work things out so that if this is seen as the final solution. What's funny about it is when you look at these studies of people who have guns, if somebody came in their house, they couldn't barely hit the side of a barn. They never fired. Most of them have never fired these guns, don't know anything about gun safety. But the whole issue of having the right to carry a gun and having the Constitution as an irreversible document 300 years later, to me, just seems somewhat ludicrous. And I just think that here again, we are in a situation where a collective sense of urgency needs to be taken, not only on the political rhetoric, but just the rhetoric in general of one individual to the other. Those people that don't have guns, if you get mad, you don't have that as an option. And so consequently, I think that the dialogue on violence in our communities, in our cities, in our local areas needs to be discussed as a health issue. I mean, if you look at some of the children that I take care of in some of the urban inner city areas, these children are afraid to go to school. These children are afraid to be involved in anything where there's a gathering of people. They're afraid of getting either fired on themselves or inadvertently shot or hurt. And when we talk about violence in our communities, much of the time we're simply talking about killings. That doesn't mean the number of people get beaten and who get shot and wounded. It doesn't take into consideration the bullying that goes on in our schools. This whole pervasive culture of violence is as unhealthy as anything we talk about here. Cancer, diabetes, heart disease, and the ramifications through our society are just immensely difficult to explain to children and to anybody else in other cultures. So consequently, here we have another. I'm not here again. I don't believe this was necessarily a political act by rational people fueled by the media, Sarah Palin, anybody else. I think it's a very disturbed individual who found a focal point, maybe through suggestion, for his target areas. And what's interesting is all these congresspeople are concerned now, Democrats and Republicans, because they know that this kind of thing could happen to any one of them. And so consequently, I think that's another thing that we need to talk about. Interesting studies on fluoride. This is too much. We've had a lot of people complaining about fluoride through the years, and now there appears to be too much fluoride for the federal government to feel comfortable with. So that's another issue that we can talk about. Certainly the whole area of what's happening in insurance, the insurance industry, as it relates to raising fees, some of the fees for one of the major insurance industries about to be raised almost 50% or more. 59%, I think, was the study. Another study on autism that talks about the whole issue of near births. That means that a baby born close to the next baby, they feel increases the incidence of autism. I think this is a story that we have to look at with a little bit of a grain of salt, because it's not a complete story. It's just merely a suggestion. And so consequently, I think we do have to pay some attention to it. However, I would be hesitant to make this a meaningful point of discussion, but you'll see it on the news. And so if it's there and that's the option, then I think we have an opportunity then to discuss it. A lot of other things that we can discuss, but I want to get started with you. Area code 510-848-4425 is the number. 1-800-958-9008 if you want to talk about a medical condition.
This is an encore show, so please don't call in today. This is an encore show.
You want to talk about disease states. You want to talk about health politics. You want to make a contribution. Then you're welcome. 848-4425. I would dare to say, Mickey, this is the only place in the Bay Area here on KPFA where people can call and actually get information directly about a specific question in health. I mean, you see people will tell you what they want you to know, but here we're asking what you want us to tell you. All right, 848-4425, the 510 area code. Let's go to Mariana in Tiburon. You're in About Health.
Hi there. I've been talking about this for years with everybody I know, and I feel like the reigning values, when you look at the reigning values, well, I'm not saying that everybody has these values, but the values that are adulated and that are being operated on as far as how our government is acting all over the world and how the media seems to portray, is money. These are the things to adulate in life: money, sex, and power. Now, there's really nothing wrong with any of those three things, but when you see those as the reigning values of our country, what are the kids going to emulate? And what does our TV and entertainment system emulate? Those exact things. If I had children now, I would throw out my TV. I don't even own a TV, actually. I just have one for exercise videos. But I don't pay for cable, and I don't use it. I don't like it. I go over a friend's house, and I sit down on the couch, talk to the woman of the family, and I can't stand to be around the noise of the violence. And if I glance over there, I see some woman being pushed or slammed on a pool table, and I think, how can people see this as entertainment? It's depraved.
It even gets to something simple. Every action movie I've seen in the last 15 years has some car chase. And the car chase...
Boring.
And they all crash into other cars. What happens to the people in these other cars they crash into? I mean, it just seems to me that these are the kinds of things that start to be where fantasy becomes reality. I mean, it just to me is crazy.
Is that enjoyable for you to watch?
No, it isn't. I mean, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
I mean, but nobody thinks about the people in these movies when the car hits some other car.
You know,
when these cars run into other people. I mean, this just seems to be like a reality that happens so often.
Well, here's the other thing. When you... The Paramahansa Yogananda, who was one of the first yogis to come to the United States, used to say he would walk in movie theaters in the dark, and before the movie would start, he would put out all these good vibes to everybody, because he said people, when they're in the dark and they're seeing visions, like in their own mind, like when you go to bed and you visualize what you will dream of or the sweetheart you're thinking of, you know, those affect your whole nervous system. This is what hypnotherapy is all about, and it goes deep into the brain, these kinds of things. Now, you look at what these kids are watching. It's guns. And who invented the games where they were taught to have fun killing people on the computer games? Guess who invented them? The military. Because they want your kids. They now have over 90,000 troops, and they're just sending 30,000 more. Last week I heard on KPFA. This is cynical. This is intentional. Wake up, mothers and fathers, and grab your kids back from this machine. It's very, very sad.
Well, you know, I'm one of those people who believes that parents have the full responsibility. For instance, I'm not in favor of taking toys out of Happy Meals. I think that's kind of ridiculous. You know why? Because I think that, you know, the parent needs to take some responsibility. We have too many instances in this country, and as it relates to health, where people are not willing to take responsibility for their own health.
Well, because they're rocked to sleep.
No, you think that. You think that. But there's some very rational people who buy these games. There are people who they listen to the lyrics of the songs.
Unbelievable.
I mean, what we have to do is we have to be very, very vigilant about what our children do, or those around us for whom we are responsible do. I agree with you that there's too much of this on television, Maren, but I believe that parents have a responsibility to take over the instruction of these children.
You're correct. I believe you're absolutely correct. And I don't think the kids would, on their own, have the discrimination, because they have to be shown a difference. I raised a boy who's now a world-famous glass artist, and we didn't have much money, but he really got a lot of knowledge because we were both artists. Well, here's the scoop. It's like if they don't have anything to compare it to, and the parents aren't really tuned in, or the parents are really stressed now. Look at the way the amount of work people have to do to make a living and everything. This has been intentional. Our government has been crippling the parents and the culture and the population.
But you know, I don't think it's government. Necessarily.
I think it's the way things are going. People have to work so hard just to make a living.
My parents worked hard in a segregated environment to raise the three of us in a violent environment in Dallas, Texas, growing up.
Oh my God.
And I'm saying to you that but there was a certain sense of responsibility that my parents had over me, and there was a certain sense of responsibility I had to them. I think if we're going to make any changes in this country, I think the individual has to take responsibility.
I know, but you know what? Look at how this station is known for educating people to a quality level. But the other stations, they're pushing all this stuff.
Well, I just think still it comes down in the area of health. Now,
I'm not saying the parents are not responsible. I think they're responsible too, but I do have compassion for them working so many hours and not having a lot of time. And I would prefer, believe me, I live in a place where I have 23 kids screaming outside my window, and I'm really unhappy about it. And I can't get any changes because the parents are not home or whatever.
But even in that environment, your son would not eat a Happy Meal. It just wouldn't happen.
So
he wouldn't buy these very popular. He wouldn't wait for the next edition of Murder Everybody as a video game. You know,
that's the name of it? Murder everybody?
I'm just being facetious and
cynical. Sorry.
But I mean, they got names like that. What I'm saying to you is I do think in the area of health, because they're going to be, I haven't seen the Brown budget. I haven't seen anybody's health budgets, but there's not going to be nearly as much money for early detection and prevention and health education. Health education never seems to get funded even in good times. So it's going to be pretty much up to the individual, his cluster, his family, his tribe, to take full responsibility for dying.
No, and
exercise.
I see them going down the tubes. I mean, they litter, and I try to say to them, look, you litter outside, you're going to get fined. They're playing with the mail. You can go to jail for that. I try to tell them, but they're, you know, they're kids. They think I'm out of my mind.
But I think in the area of health, because of the restriction and resources we're going to see over the next several years.
Oh, they better eat well.
That those of you who know in your family and those of whom you're responsible, you better start talking diet, exercise, and stress reduction. You know, otherwise, it's not going to come from anybody else. But thank you for taking the time.
Well, bless you. And I really do. I call upon the parents, wake up. They're stealing your children's minds, and they're going to get them in their wars, and it's really sick.
And you know, we're on the second generation of these video game parents, so that these are parents that grew up with these games. So.
Yeah, and I lost two fiancés in the Vietnam War, you know. I mean, this is disgusting. And they want these kids for all these wars they want to have. They have to have these kids. Well, steal your kids back.
Right.
Don't let them play those games.
All right, let's go to, thank you very much, Marianne.
Thank you.
Let's go to Lori and Sandra Fell. You're on About Health.
Hello, Dr. Lidar.
Hello, Lori.
Hello, Mariana. I know your previous caller, and I agree with her. But I was calling about a personal problem.
Okay.
I have, for several months, had mild nausea.
Okay.
And I went to my doctor, and she gave me something called famotidine.
Okay.
And but I want to take more control over my health, and I want to know if it's some, if I can eat different to have that change, or if this could be the symptom of something more serious that you could advise me about.
Well, let me ask you: do you have any vomiting associated with that?
No.
So just nausea. That's the only symptom.
And it's very mild.
Okay. And could you describe just very briefly what some of those symptoms are like?
It's just nausea. It's in the upper part of my abdomen, below my breasts, and above my, what I think of my stomach, but I'm not sure quite where my stomach is. Maybe it's right at my stomach. It's in that diaphragm area.
Well, you know, the nausea, the differential for nausea is just so extensive.
Yeah.
That just to kind of go through it, I do think there are a couple of things.
They did a bunch of blood tests, and everything came up normal.
Yeah, well, I think that what I would do is this. Since most nausea is associated with eating,
mm-hmm.
and what I would do is to keep diets over the next couple of weeks,
uh-huh.
and see which one, and see if you can make some associations between the things that you eat,
uh-huh.
and your case, and the degree of nausea that you have,
uh-huh.
and then go back over those diets and see if there's some commonalities,
okay.
and then eliminate those things from your diet and see what happens, because you're at the point now. If there, all the studies have been done, then there's nothing. Then you know the medical system. When all the studies are normal, tends to kind of write you off
mm-hmm.
at that point. You're pretty much on your own.
When the testing
comes back negative,
right.
they tend to kind of write you off and say, well,
right.
you know, this is all we can do and there's nothing serious. But nothing serious doesn't help most people.
Someone referred me to a book called The pH Miracle or something like that.
Yeah, well, there are a lot of those books around. But I think before you do that, you need to know your diet anyway to look at the pH of what you're doing. So I would keep diaries for the next 3 weeks to a month and see if you can associate any of those diets and foods with the nausea that you have. And then even if you go to diets, at least you know where you are at baseline.
Yeah. Okay, I'll do it.
All right, 848-4425 is our number in the 51 area code. We're open for any questions that you might have about health, any contributions you want to make, any ideas you have about how to stop the unhealthy environment in our communities that breed violence and other forms of health disparities. So 848-4425, 1-800-958-9008. Daniel, you're in About Health.
Good afternoon, Dr. Lenore.
Good afternoon, Daniel.
A lot of topics today.
I've got a lot of phone calls, so.
Yeah. Quick comment about fluoride. Most people don't know this, but how we got fluoride in our water was in the process of refining gold, they use a chemical called hydrofluoric acid in what is called the scrubbing process. And that chemical is so toxic and so corrosive that it can't be sold. You can't put a drop of it in, I shouldn't say no, it can be sold. You can't put a drop of it in a lake, an ocean, a stream, whatever. But you can sell it. And the person who buys it, or the corporation who buys it, can do whatever they want with it. And someone came up with the brilliant idea to alleviate corporations that used this and had just untold hundreds of millions of barrels of it stored to put it in the water supply. That's how we got fluoridated water. Internal ingestion of fluoride does absolutely no good whatsoever for your teeth or any other part, but it does horrific things in your body, too numerous to go into right now. But I thought I'd give a quick overview of that. I'm against water fluoridation, pretty obviously.
Well, you know, it's interesting because for years I have defended the fluoridation of water based upon the statistics that I have seen. But what's happened is the U.S. government officials have lowered the recommendation. The Department of Health and Human Services lowered its recommended levels to 0.7 milligrams of fluoride per liter of water, the lower limit of the current recommendations. And so I'm surprised to see this. There are several reasons for the change, but they did a health assessment study on whether some children may not get too much fluoride, and the study concluded that some children under the age of 8 may be overexposed to fluoride, at least occasionally because of the high levels in the water. And people have been saying this kind of thing for years, and so I'm really kind of surprised to see that all of a sudden they're kind of backtracking on some of these fluoride recommendations and some of the things that people have been fighting fluoride in an organized fashion for years. And so, Daniel, thank you very much for that historical. Hello? Is he gone? Well, Daniel, we appreciate your contributions every week. Let's go to Rodney in Oakland. You're on About Health.
Good afternoon. I just have a quick question for you. About 2 years ago, I was diagnosed with prostate cancer at the PSA of 10. And since then, it has went down to a PSA of about 1.9. And I wanted to know, does that mean there's no more cancer in my system?
Well, you would have to assume that, here's what you have to assume, that the PSA of 10 was an aberration. If you've had several, for most people who don't know, PSA means prostate
specific antigen,
right? And how many high measurements did you have?
That was the highest, and I went and got, you know, a radical treatment, and from then, and I changed my lifestyle also.
Now, what kind of treatment did you get?
It was brachytherapy.
Oh, so yeah, so you've had treatment. So that means that you probably did have some form of prostate cancer. Probably had a biopsy to suggest that.
Right.
Sometimes what happens though is, and I'd have to talk to the brachytherapist because I know that if you have surgery, you want the PSA to be zero. And sometimes when it comes back and starts to increase in level, they worry about cancer in the bed where they took the prostate from. And those people will require additional treatment. But I don't know what's the acceptable level right now for brachytherapy. Did you talk to your therapist about it? I mean, the guy that inserted the seeds, the doctor?
I have not, because I've been satisfied with the results. And again, because of exercise and diet change and other lifestyle changes that I've underwent, I just have not gone back to the doctor because I see that, you know, the results were positive, but I just didn't think calling the doctor to find out whether or not the reduction from a 10 to a 1 means that there's no cancer.
Yeah, I think that I would talk to him because one of the things that, like I say, one of the things that happens is that in when surgery is used for the PSA, then what happens is that you want to see it down to zero. And if it starts to rise, then the concern is that is there additional cancer in the bed? So I think that the PSA gradually, with most brachytherapy, goes down gradually. So I'm not sure what the acceptable level is. So I would call my therapist. And how many PSAs have you had since the treatments?
3.
And they've all been 1 or less?
No, they've been coming down gradually from 10 to 7.
Yeah, now that's what you expect in brachytherapy. And I would expect them to continue to go down. But I don't know what the floor is for that number.
So you
just have to call him and ask him.
Thank you a whole lot. You take good care.
And for most people to understand brachytherapy, it's the insertion of kind of like radioactive seeds into the bed of the prostate in order to kill the tumor and to deactivate the prostate.
Right.
That's opposed to surgery where usually the prostate is removed. But thank you very much for having us. For sharing that with us.
And thank you for sharing with me, Doctor.
Our number is 510-848-4425 and 1-800-958-9008. It's a chance for you to get some of your questions answered and make a contribution. Let's go to Mary Louise. You're on About Health.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Well, this program began by speaking about violence in our communities. And one of the things that I have found maybe having a little bit of impact is to speak up about things we know about. I did a television program for a few years, and it was very interesting how many young people would come up to me when they saw me or whatever and speak about how they really were thinking about the subject of violence, nonviolence, and at times going back to the issue of war. And I was just thinking, as you were speaking earlier, that there are probably very many elderly people that are very clear in their heads and that could speak about that kind of violence, since we live in this time of so many violent, harmful, I don't know what words to use, even video games. And not only those, I was once in a toy store, Toys R Us, it happened to be called, and I heard a horrible noise coming from the other side of an aisle, and it said, "Kill! Kill! Kill!" So I went around, and a child had activated a doll that had this programmed into it, obviously a battery-operated doll, you know, and it's as if, how can this be? How can we live in a world where children have a doll that screams kill? Anyway, so I'm just thinking that maybe we can make use of some of the elders to speak to children and speak of some of their experiences, obviously not to frighten them to pieces, but to teach them something about that violence is something we really want to stay away from, as well as war, of course, instead of feeding it in any way.
Well, that's a good suggestion, and thank you very much for that, Mary Louise.
Thank you very much.
All right, I think we all have an obligation to speak up about these issues, and I think that those people put themselves in the line of the real heroes in these issues. But we talk to kids about violence a lot, but when you're in the environment in which they find themselves, it's very difficult if you're the only nonviolent one. So consequently, you may win some small battles, but I'm not sure how much of the war you're going to win with that kind of philosophy and without role models and exceptional options. And that's why I'm very disturbed. I haven't seen the new budgets, either the national ones or the local ones or the state ones. But I know they're going to cut out some very essential, what we call safety net programs. And I think for the health of our communities, we need to fight for some of these programs to be maintained. So anyway, let's go down to Nance, to Amethyst in Berkeley. You're in about health. Amethyst?
So many things. One thing is fluorides. The man who spoke about fluorides never mentioned the fact that in 1977, the proposition was put on the ballot here about fluoridating water. I voted against it, and it, unfortunately, won. And we are living with fluoridated water in this city, and nobody seems to know about it anymore. In fact, you can go to the drugstore and buy fluoridated water by the gallon, and the people are so stupid, they buy it, not knowing it coming out of your own tap.
Yeah, well, yeah, I think that these pushbacks on these recommendations are some cause for concern. I don't know exactly what they mean, but I do think that it's something that we need to pay attention to and maybe give more credibility to that part of our population that's been talking against fluoride for all this time. I'm a little disappointed it took us so long to get to this point, but thank you for that.
But I want to know why nobody ever mentions it when they talk about people buying bottled water and how bad it is to buy bottled water. Yeah,
but somebody just did. You did.
Well, I had never heard anybody even mention that it's fluoridated water we have here. Nobody.
But that's why you would encourage your friends to listen to About Health, because you just mentioned it. And we appreciate that. And I think that if there are other opportunities for you to call and to talk to other health providers or health people or even on just general programs, and then I think you ought to continue to do it, because you're very passionate, very articulate, and I think you would make a very good spokesman for that point of view. So thank you very much, Amethyst. All right, 848-4425 in the 510 area code, 1-800-958-9008. Let's go to Nancy in Fresno. You're on About Health.
Hi, Dr. Lenore.
How you doing?
I'm doing just fine. I love your show, and I'm so glad I have an opportunity to just run this by you. It's something that has been concerning me. 6 years ago, I had breast cancer, and I had radiation.
Uh-huh.
And I had about 4,500 to 5,000 rads of radiation. And it does concern me that there could be a bad outcome from this, another cancer. And I know that the chance of that is low, and it also touched just a portion of my lung, and that kind of concerns me about the future. But one thing, my question that is disturbing me right now is it's time for a mammogram again. And I've already had so much radiation that I am really reluctant to submit to another mammogram when I'm wondering if ultrasound or thermography or if there's something else where I can be screened and it just doesn't add to this radiation load. What do you think about that? I don't want to seem unreasonable, but I am concerned about that.
Well, you know, I think that you should be concerned. I do think that whenever you get a test in medicine, there are two terms I want people in our audience to remember.
Uh-huh.
One is risk and one is benefit.
Uh-huh.
So that if you have the kind of cancer where a mammogram gives the doctors and the treating people the best option to determine whether or not, you know, you have a recurrence or there's any additional growth, then I think that the radiation risk is relatively small given that scenario. But if in fact you have the kind of cancer where another technique, and I'm not, you know, up to date on all the latest techniques for the detection of breast cancer is available to you, then perhaps the doctor or the treating and evaluative therapist is not concerned about your concerns, and there may be other options. You'd have to talk with the specifics of your kind of cancer and where it was and all of that.
Mm-hmm.
I think in a situation where we're talking about screening, then I think that's more of a concern than when we're talking about someone with previously diagnosed cancer. So
uh-huh.
I think that you may have to go along with an additional radiation exposure based upon the kind of cancer you have and the need that your people that are taking care of you have for information. So,
well, when I had faithfully been getting my mammograms every year from 40,
right.
And I was diagnosed at 50. And what was interesting is I had my mammogram at the beginning of August, and it was September 1st, just 3 weeks later when I found my own lump. So evidently, I don't know how long I'd had it, but evidently what I did have was never seen on the mammogram to begin with.
Mm-hmm.
And then to submit to more radiation, of course, after I was diagnosed, there were several mammograms, and these were diagnostic. They just weren't the screening mammograms. So no one knows the limit when you go over. And so, you know, it's kind of like which cigarette gives you cancer type of thing.
Right. No, I think that your concern, sometimes in medicine what happens is that doctors continue to do the same thing over because they don't recognize your need, for your concerns about the therapy that they're giving you.
Mm-hmm.
So I think if you mention that to your therapist, if there are other options available to you, especially because breast cancer is not one disease, it's many diseases,
uh-huh.
I would be reluctant to give you more information.
Uh-huh.
But I certainly would talk to and share your concerns, with the treating physician and see what happens.
Well, I will. I'm going to run that by him because I am concerned. So, okay, I just wanted to run that by you and make sure I wasn't being unbalanced
Whenever, you know, one of the things that bothers me most about people on being unbalanced in the healthcare system is when they don't ask questions.
It
amazes me when people go
All
in.
All right, thank you so much for your input. I appreciate it.
All right, 848-4425, the 510 area code, 1-800-958-9008. We're asking for your participation. You got a question, you got an answer, you've got, a disease process, you know, someone that you want to talk about in terms of their own health, or you've got something on health politics, just give us a call, 1-800-848-4425. We have a couple open lines. Let's go to David. You're on About Health.
Hi there. How are you doing?
I'm good, David.
Doctor,
how are you?
Good to hear from you. Listen, you've been stretching the long over from gun control to fluoride. Mm-hmm. I just want to make a correction there. I think fluoride is a byproduct of the bauxite, mm-hmm. An aluminum manufacturing, and not gold, as the previous caller said. Gun control. Well, I think everyone should be taught how to use guns properly. What happened in the 8th century is that the Vikings came over and robbed all the monks because they were taught only to worship and not how to defend. What do you think?
Well, here's what I think. One of the interesting statistics that most people don't recognize is that, you know why so many people drive in drive-by shootings? It's because the shooters never had a chance to shoot a gun before they started driving by. In the 8th century, I'm sure that people used guns for a whole lot of other things, knew how to use them, knew the dangers of them, you know, basically knew how to care for them and to probably use them more appropriately. They were probably used less for shooting people than they were for shooting game and other things. Now, these people, most people in listening audience who have a gun have hardly ever fired the gun. So if someone comes into the house, they're as likely, and this has been shown, to shoot a family member as to shoot an intruder. And so consequently, I mean, we're not in the 8th century anymore. We're in the 21st century. And under those circumstances, if you think that you and your neighbors can defend themselves with these handguns from somebody who really wants to invade your neighborhood with the kinds of weaponry that the Mexican cartels have, then I think that you got a problem. So I think I agree with you. If you've got a gun and you know about gun safety and you know how to use it, then I think that you have the right to own it by the Constitution. I personally don't go along with that, but I can't argue from a constitutional perspective.
Also, guns can be taken away from you and used against yourself.
Absolutely, but I've seen this happen. I mean, here's what bothers me about most people with guns. Now, if I get angry with a spouse or a domestic partner, the most I can really do is walk in my house is just to walk out of the house. Now, when people have access to guns, they can take that to another level. And I think that that's the biggest problem. Most people...
That is so wrong. You don't escalate.
Yeah, but I think that if you have the option...
Yeah, that's why you have to have a training. And everyone should know how to use a gun.
Well, that may be... That's only everybody with one.
Especially those who don't have any.
But everybody with one should know how to use it. But
exactly.
In those drive-by shootings, the reason so many people are shot... is because for some of those guys that fire, or women that fire those guns, that's the first time they ever fired.
Well, now we're going into peer pressure instead of family pressure.
Right, well...
Yeah, that's a whole different subject.
But in the 8th century, I think they had a little bit better perspective on these guns. But thank you very much for your contribution.
Oh, no, thank you. I'm glad you have your show.
All right. Carolyn and Anisha, you're on About Health. Carolyn? All right, let's go to Lillian in Visalia. Lillian?
Thank you so much. Yes, thank you so much for taking my call. My daughter has been suffering from some kind of lymphoid problem for a few years now, and she had one removed from her neck, and now it's into the eye area. It's called lymphoid hyperplasia, and she's being referred to a medical specialist, but it seems like it's taken so long, and I did some of my own investigative work, you know, on Google and et cetera,
right.
And found out that there's something called sarcoidosis and uveitis.
Right.
And it can lead to inflammation of the eye and blindness. I'd like to know if you could comment on all the different kind of autoimmune problems that are out there.
Well, yeah, just in a very general way, autoimmunity suggests that something goes wrong with the immune system and it either goes wrong with it or is a byproduct of its attempt to do something else, and it starts attacking itself. It can occur in a number of different ways. For instance, allergy in some ways is an autoimmune system because one of your antibody kind of supposed to do this does that. So then there are other types where, you know, you have the body attacking itself, like you see with lupus or sarcoidosis or dermatomyositis,
right.
Or any one of those, Sjögren syndrome. So that's a situation where you have the body attacking itself. Sarcoidosis is a little bit different in the sense that that sarcoid is more what you call, I'm trying to get the term, but it's a situation where the body just kind of responds to something, and you then have additional problems. But
doctor, I just want to interrupt and tell you, I never realized just how many different kinds of diseases can attack a body. It just amazes me. You think your kids are healthy, and then, boom, they get something. No, and it's catastrophic.
You know, I think that what happens is that, and it takes a long time for people to make the diagnosis. I think when you have a lot of lymph nodes, people tend to pay more attention because they think, they think either of lymphoma or they think of some kind of a an infectious disease. So
you'd
like to get more attention paid to that. But if you look at the number of diseases that are autoimmune, then you are, you're looking at a whole host of diseases that can start very subtly causing symptoms that are difficult to pinpoint onto one disease and then ultimately blossom into something else.
Exactly.
So I think if she's had a lot, if she's had, that many lymph nodes, then one of them ought to be biopsied and looked at.
And it was lymphoid hyperplasia. And again, that's non-malignant. They can never figure it out.
Yeah, that just means that something has happened in the body. The body's tried to respond, and there's no tumor, and there's no evidence of...
Once it gets into the eye, it can lead to blindness. Is that correct?
I don't know that for a fact. I think you have to have something else going on as a focal point in the eye in order for that to happen. I don't think that that leads directly to blindness. I think most often you if it's in response to something, and that something impacts the eye, and then the body attacks the eye as well. I think that's when you get blindness. But generally, you don't get blindness from that just as the primary cause.
Well, thank you so much, Doctor. You're wonderful. I appreciate it.
You're quite welcome. 848-4425 in the 588 in the 510 area. 1-800-958-9008. Let's go to Philip in Oakland. You're on About Health.
Hi, Doctor. Always love your show. And I came in late, so I hope I'm not repeating. But the fellow that gun control. Guns are just out of control in this country, and I agree with you. And, the thing is, people don't realize, you also said, spouses kill each other. The saddest thing is where I grew up, everybody has guns, hunting rifles, and kids would shoot their siblings because they'd be playing and somebody would leave the damn gun loaded. And then they'd shoot their brother or sister. It happened 2 or 3 times. So anyway, we need to do something, but, I don't know. Like you say, it's almost impossible. Thanks so much. Great show.
All right. Well, thank you very much for that comment. But I think when you talk about the health of a community, you got to start talking about violence. I mean, it impacts so many things. It impacts our children probably more than it does us as adults, because in these peer-to-peer relationships and the teenage areas with the gangs and the guns and drugs and the whole deal, that any child who gets to school safely on any given day, we got to pray for. And so I think that that violence in our communities ramifies throughout everything. You look at the incidence of asthma is higher in violent communities. Stress is higher. All kinds of things are higher in underserved communities or in communities where violence is a factor. So when you talk about health, we can't talk about it without violence. I think this situation in Arizona is just an unhealthy reminder of what happens in situations like that. All right, now let's go to Craig. You're on About Health.
Hi, thanks for taking my call.
Sure.
Thinking about this violent issue, there's a documentary that was made recently called Mean World Syndrome. And, it's this concept that's been developed about the media. You know, there's so much violence in the media. If it bleeds, it leads. And I really think that for progressives, we could develop a pretty good debate around this issue if we went to this documentary. It's like I say, it's called Mean World Syndrome, and you can Google it and you can see trailers from the DVD. But this would be a great community organizing tool. We could show it in communities, and I really think it would be helpful. So
I remember that, because the premise of that was that there's so much violence on TV that it scares people half to death, more than the reality of the circumstances in which they live. I think one of the byproducts of 9/11 is that, and it was a bit surprising, I think, that obviously this was a major tragedy for our country and for the people involved. But it just scared people all over the country to the point where we have been, you almost wonder if whatever was intended has occurred. I mean, we're so fearful about everything now that it threatens, I think, an open society. And so I think that mean world syndrome is an interesting one because it presupposes that there's so much violence in the mass media that we're looking over our shoulder. And the one that gets me is this, what's this one, Criminal Minds. Now, that just gets me more than anything else because they make sure that two or three people die before they catch anybody. You know, I don't know if you've ever seen this show on TV.
No, I haven't.
It's the one
this guy who's a big part of the documentary, he might be somebody you could interview on your program. His name is Michael Morgan.
Yeah, okay,
He teaches at UMass, and one of the things that they talk about is that, you know, people want to arm themselves to the teeth because they think that this world is just filled with, violence at every turn, and I don't know. That's just my two cents.
Yeah, but that's what gets me. Criminal Minds to me is the penultimate of this kind of thing. Because here these people are tracking these mass, I won't look at it, tracks these mass murderers, and they always make sure that the guy kills two or three people in the hour before they catch him. And so consequently, and it's always, look to me, it looks almost more dangerous to have them helping you than if you're just dealing with the mass murder yourself. But in any event, I agree that this is a phenomenon where the mass media scare you so much that you react you're not reacting to the reality, you're reacting to the circumstances that are created for you by this group of media. But thank you for that call. All right, our next caller is Rachel in Berkeley. You're on About Health.
Are you taking general calls?
We are.
Oh, I have a question, and thank you so much for your show in previous months. What are the benefits of the chickenpox vaccine for a 16-year-old girl who has not been exposed to chickenpox?
Well,
and also the problems. And I'll take my call off the air. So if you could give me a sense of both the advantages and the disadvantages, I'd appreciate it.
Well, I think that one of the problems with chickenpox is that it's a much worse disease when adults catch it. And the morbidity and mortality associated with it is much greater. The other thing is that the chickenpox vaccine that they get when they are younger tends to wear out before the teenage years, and so therefore the recommendation for an additional dose. But in adults, the chickenpox is a much worse disease than it is in children.
So is there a value to giving the vaccine to a girl for the first time when she's 16?
There's a protocol to give them vaccines. I think there probably is a value, but it's not as great as when they're children.
What are the disadvantages to not getting the vaccine if you haven't had chickenpox?
Well, the disadvantages is it's just simply that it puts you at risk for a worse disease if you do get it. And the other part, the more broader perspective is that it makes you a part of the herd. It keeps you out of the herd. That means that you are one of those people who could carry chickenpox to someone else.
Mm-hmm.
But there really is it's a very rare problem in adults. But when it does occur, it's a much more serious problem.
All right, and that's the association with shingles. Is that the problem?
Well, there is an association with shingles. It's not clear. Shingles is the same virus. But it's not clear that immunization for chickenpox prevents you from getting shingles.
So would you give a 16, almost 17-year-old girl?
You know, I probably would because I believe in vaccines. And I've seen over my career the devastation that we used to take care of. And in my office, we used to have to see 50 to 60 to 70 patients with a variety of different diseases that are now prevented by vaccines. But I don't want to get into a whole vaccine discussion.
Okay. Thank you so much. I appreciate your time.
All right.
Love your show. Bye.
848-4425, the 51 area code, 1-800-958-9008. Let's go to Anthony in Pittsburgh. You're in About Health.
Hi, Doctor. I just had a question about these PG&E smart meters. I heard a show on KPFA a couple of weeks ago, and I went online and found people are up in arms all over the place about it. I've been sick for about 6 months with this dizziness and this kind of nausea and this kind of anxiety in my chest. I've been to doctors. They haven't been able to tell me a thing. And when they're talking about the smart meters and the symptoms, it seems I have the same symptoms that they're discussing. But what they didn't bring up is that on apartment buildings like mine, I have 9 smart meters on the wall of my bedroom. I'm on the second floor. These smart meters on the first floor, right under my bed. And the, what they were talking about on the show was just having one smart meter on your house causing people symptoms. So do you know anything about this? Is there any validity to this thing?
You know, I really don't know. I think that, you know, if you're having the kinds of symptoms that you have, all I would say is that, you know, you keep this in the back of your mind, but make sure that you're pursuing other areas that can explain this, you know, a little bit better in terms of your clinical symptoms. But as far as knowing about the PG&E smart meter controversy, I'm really not well versed on it, and I'm sure there are people audience who may know more about it. What most people are concerned about is that they misread the information and people end up getting charged more money for because of the smart.
Yeah, well, my concern was the microwave signal. They're saying it's 15 times stronger than a cell phone, and I've got 9 of them on my wall, so I'm getting 9 times the exposure of the average person with a home.
Well, you know, I know that people believe that, and I don't have enough information to refute any of that. But I do think if you're having all these symptoms, make sure that you don't just focus on this one differential diagnostic area, because it sounds like you've got there's a lot of serious things going on around you that that you know, you've been looking for help, you haven't gotten it yet, and I think putting all my eggs in one basket diagnostically when people don't know what's wrong is probably not the right way to go about that. I think you
can. Continue to go to doctors. I actually haven't even brought this up with doctors. I'm trying to see what they come up with.
Maybe we can get some more information for you, and maybe check in next week, and maybe someone who has been part of this controversy can call in and explain what the issues are. But I thank you for taking the time to call. Let's go now to Dr. Larry Rose in Mill Valley. You're on About Health.
Yeah, hi. This is Dr. Larry Rose. I'm a public health medical officer with Cal OSHA for 28 years.
Uh-huh.
I just read a book on fluoridation by Dr. Connett, and I was very impressed with the book. It's a paperback, and it can be picked up at any bookstore. The points I want to make are that, first of all, the major fluorides that are put in our water, you know, it's hexafluoride, salicylic acid, and that comes from the phosphate mining industry, mostly in Florida. It's a very toxic byproduct, and that's what's added to our water, not a, say, a pure pharmaceutical grade fluoride like say, sodium fluoride. It is this toxic byproduct. The second point I want to make is that, you know, as a public health doctor, and I did a lot of epidemiology and toxicology, the most impressive evidence for fluoridation saving teeth, say, you know, diminishing dental caries, is very flimsy. The evidence that I look at and have reviewed shows that where they do not fluoridate, in almost all of the countries of Europe, they have no difference in the rate of dental caries that we have here where we do fluoridate. And the final point I want to make is that fluoridation puts you at risk for the deposition of the fluorides in the teeth that cause up to 25% dental fluorosis in young children. Those depositions also occur in the bone. And there's very real evidence that that puts people at increased risks for fractures, particularly hip fractures in older people. And my problem right now is osteoarthritis, and it does up the risk for osteoarthritis. So I wanted to make those points.
Well, I think that, Dr., I would have to be one of those people who have looked at this peer-reviewed literature over the years and have been, you know, more of an advocate for fluoridation than against it, although I'm not really expressed much of a philosophical point in the media. But this is very disturbing that all of a sudden now, I mean, after years and years of denying and saying this was all the greatest success of the 20th century, the EPA is trying to walk it back, you know, as if, oh, well, you know, maybe it's instead of, you know, maybe a bit more concerned about fluoride than they express. So I think we have to take another look at fluoride in this country and see if the EPA gives us a clearer idea as to exactly why they reduce these recommendations and what fluoride really means to us as a culture. So I appreciate your concern, and I appreciate real information at all times. So thank you for doing that for us.
Well, thank you for your program. It's excellent.
All right, let's go to Hector in Porterville. You're in About Health.
Yes, hello, doctor. Thank you for taking my call.
Sure, Hector.
My question is, I have a 2.5-year-old son, and he was diagnosed with, I don't know the proper term, but his tear ducts are blocked, so whenever he cries or gets tears going, they just seem to fall out versus, I don't know if I'm describing it correctly, but they just seem to roll more than usual off of his eyes. And they said that it's an operation that could be done to him where something to do with it connecting to the nose, and it's a procedure that's not really risky. Because what happens at times, he'll get infections in his eyes due to that, and we put medicine on him, and it goes away. But it's more of a question: should we wait till he gets a little older to do this surgery on him, or should we do it now as he's 2.5 years old? I don't know if you're familiar with that. What I'm trying to describe.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I mean, the lacrim, the tear ducts are called the lacrimal ducts, and when you cry, they drain into the nose. I think that you know it's a fairly common problem for children. I think something like six or seven percent of children have blocked tear ducts. I think that the operation to open those tear ducts is relatively easy to do, because it's really most of the time it's just a probe that they put in there or to open up the ducts. And I'm not sure that it's absolutely essential to have any particular operation. I think sometimes the ducts open up by themselves, but it's really just a simple probing procedure, and it's usually not done in adults because it doesn't really help, but it does seem to be more helpful in children. So I think that if your doctor feels that this is a fairly simple procedure to do, then I think it's probably worth it, because otherwise the tears kind of well up in the eyes, and sometimes there may be a bit more increase in infection, but not much. So I think it's just a decision that you have to make based upon what he proposes to do.
Our major concern was that they have to, him being small, they have to put him under anesthesia, versus if he gets a little older, they might be able to do that procedure while he's awake.
Yeah, I don't think there's any risk for waiting. I really don't.
Okay, yeah, that's what we felt, to wait maybe, and they say to massage the area and it might even go away.
Right, and I think that will protect you until you're ready to make that decision.
Yeah, well, thank you, doctor. Appreciate it.
All right, let's go to Nancy in Oakland. You're on About Health. Oh, we've got time for one more question. Nancy, you're on About Health.
Okay, hi. I wanted to address the question you had from a couple callers back, where he was concerned about all those smart meters right next to his bed.
Okay.
Lena Berman on Tuesday at 1:00 on KPFA has been having some programs, and they've done a lot of research, and they're in touch with other people who have done research about it, and who some of them have been up, I think, in Marin and in Napa Valley, have been able to get PG&E to take them back out. But I don't know what he could do with the apartment, but, you know, and a whole apartment thing. But I think probably if he talks to Lena Berman or listens at 1:00 on Tuesdays, I forget the name of the program.
What's the name of that program? Well, I just have my...
Yours is on About Health.
No, I'm going to get it for you.
Okay.
Health and Fitness.
Health and Fitness, yeah. And she's even got a website and such, and I just don't recall what it is, but her name is Lena Berman, and she has a program Tuesday at 1, and she'd be very happy to help that guy find information and try to take care of it. And she's seen a lot of patients who've had the kinds of symptoms he's talked about, and when they move away from the smart meters, those symptoms disappear.
All right. Well, thank you very much for giving us that information.
For your openness. Thank you.
That's why I love the KPFA audience. They know something about everything. And so I think that's a good thing. And Greg, I'm sorry we won't have time to take your call today because we're running out of time. But once again, thanks, Vicki, for the help that she's given me and KPFA for giving me the opportunity to do exactly what we're doing today, which is to talk to you and get your ideas about things and to give your ideas about some of the health issues and some of your personal health issues. Remember, we got a pledge period coming up pretty soon. I want you to stay around for that, and I want our audience to contribute more than their share this time. We're going to figure out when that all is, and maybe we'll have some information on that for you next week. But remember, health is your biggest asset. I'm Dr. Mike Lenore. We'll talk again next week.
Blues, a rare mix of Hebrew and Arabic, mixed with blues, jazz, funk, and West African grooves, opens the 26th Jewish Music Festival, Saturday, March 5th, at Freight and Salvage in Berkeley. Other festival highlights through March 13th include the Gare Mandolin Ensemble, directed by mandolin wizard Mike Marshall and a dozen top players. Odessa Havana, a klezmer Cuban celebration. Voretsky Pass, with leading artists of the world's klezmer scene. Noah Bendix Bagley, a violin virtuoso showcasing Russian Jewish music, and a finale dance party. Tickets as low as $10 at jewishmusicfestival.org or 866-558-4253. All events accessible by BART. This program benefits the Jewish Community Center of the East Bay.
And this is listener-sponsored radio, KPFA or KPFA.